No, I thank you for that tremendous privilege, responsibility that parents partake in this and undertake in this. It's a serious, serious business raising children, especially in 2021. Lord willing, in the new year, we'll deal with some things about that, actually, from that passage of Deuteronomy, some things I've already written down for us as parents. It's not for the faint at heart. It's not for the feeble or for the fearful, but for the faithful. And God will give us wisdom. Well, I'm so glad you're here tonight. God has already given us a wonderful service. I think he's already met with us some tonight. Would you not agree? Well, let's continue on. And if you turn your Bibles to the book of Psalms, Psalm 147, if you have your Bibles with you tonight. John 17:3, our theme verse for this year, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Our theme for this year is only God. In Psalm chapter 1, verse 47, we'll see a passage of Scripture dedicated to praise to God. The last five Psalms are written in a section of praise to our Lord, ending with Psalm 150. 147, if you take the time tonight, we'll actually read the entire Psalm where the Bible says, praise ye the Lord, for it is good to, and what is the next word? One more time, what's that word?
Sing.
Sing what? Sing praises. So singing is in the Bible. You see that? It is what to sing praises? It is what? What is it? Is it good or is it bad?
Good.
It is good to sing. Remember that. We're going to come back to that in just a few minutes. For it is pleasant and praise is comely. The Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathereth together the outcast of Israel. He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds. Aren't you glad that God heals a broken in heart? Is your heart ever broken? I know this year there was a number of heartaches for people, especially connected to First Baptist Church, but across the world, across the globe. And at times it could seem as if God doesn't care and didn't care. We know that not to be true. But beyond that, the Bible tells us here, and the psalmist reminds us that God heals the broken in heart. When your heart is broken, people turn to many different things. But only one can heal and mend the brokenhearted. And his name is Jehovah, God. He telleth the number of the stars, he calleth them all by their names. Verse 5, great is our Lord, and of great power, his understanding is infinite. The Lord lifted up the meek, he casteth the wicked down to the ground. Sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving, sing praise unto the harp unto our God, who covereth the heaven with clouds, who prepareth rain for the earth, who maketh grass to grow upon the mountains. He giveth to the beast his food, and to the young ravens which cry. He delighteth not in the strength of the horse. He taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him, in those that hope in his mercy. God is not impressed by what we do or who we are. God is impressed, God is moved by our hope, our confidence, or this, our faith in him. Hebrews 11:6, for without faith it is impossible to please him. You may be saved but not walking by faith. God is moved by faith. When Jesus was on earth, I believe it's three times the Bible says he marveled while on earth. Each time it says he marveled, it is always attached to noticing and being marveled or marveling at someone's faith. Not how strong you are, not how smart you are, not how cunning you are. It says he doesn't take pleasure in that, but he takes pleasure in those that fear him and those that hope in his mercy, faith in him. Verse 12, praise the Lord. O Jerusalem, praise thy God, O Zion, for he has strengthened the bars of thy gates. He hath blessed thy children within thee. He maketh peace in thy borders and filleth thee with the finest of the wheat. He sendeth forth his commandment upon earth. His word runneth very swiftly. He giveth snow like wool. He scattereth the hoarfrost like ashes. He casteth forth his ice like morsels. Who can stand before his cold? He sendeth out his word and melteth them. He causeth his wind to blow, and the waters flow. He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. He hath not dealt so with any nation, and as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. Lord, I thank you for this time that we have. Lord, I ask that you would, in these next few moments, cause us to turn towards you. Lord, would your Spirit work? Lord, help me to say those things that I should say. Lord, I need your help. I desperately crave your Spirit working through me. Lord, apart from you, we can do nothing. Lord, tonight I ask you to turn our hearts, our minds, and our spirit towards you. Lord, may we be a beacon of praise in a unison of voices and lives, Lord, that glorify you. In Jesus' name I ask. Amen. 2020 is now behind us. It's in the books. Fairly soon, it'll be in our history books. The year of the global pandemic. For years, they will write articles and study what happened in 2020. Lives upended. Other lives lost. Countries changed fundamentally. Freedoms once enjoyed, now, I believe, gone from our landscape and our landscapes forever. How will 2020 grace the history books? Well, we don't know exactly. Some will be told with blazing success stories. We conquered 2020 and came out victorious as a human race. Others with stories, wow, we couldn't even control a small virus. 2020 is past, and as I mentioned this morning, we'd like to say it again, 2020 was not a make it or break it year for Christians. 2020 was merely a revealer of what's inside. 2020 just showed us what was right here all along. This morning, I stepped on some toes. I may be on the same thread tonight. If it makes you unpleasant, I would apologize, but it's futile. I wonder what was shown from your life in 2020. Wonder what was revealed from your heart in 2020. So we look at the myriad of articles, posts, discussions, a number of things that flow to the surface with different, maybe, touches. Defiance, avoidance, rejection, disbelief, fear, understanding, misunderstanding. Coupled to an election that was unlike any election that I can remember in my 40 years on earth. And again, people's minds, thoughts, conversations filled with all of the here and now. 2020, I believe, revealed something very dramatic in our lives. It did not reveal rebellion. It did not reveal defiance or comfort. Those are merely symptoms of what was revealed in 2020. And I'm afraid that if many Christians were to pull back the veil of 2020, what they would see is not God and only God, but what they would see is self. And how life revolves around me. Things claim like, you don't care about anyone. If you cared about lives, fill in the blank. Distracted by a pandemic. Disgruntled by an election that did not go like many people hoped. I was on a text chain of other pastors. I complained to my wife about this. Because this text chain was blown up repeatedly at day and night. I'd be lying in bed, and I eventually muted this text chain about 20, 25 pastors around the state. And what was like text after text was completely election related. Now, I'm American. I'm also Puerto Rican, in case you didn't know that. I'm pro-life. I'm pro-marriage. I'm pro-democracy. I vote with my faith and by my faith, but my allegiance is to Him. And I wish that I received texts of Bible verses as frequently as I receive texts about Donald Trump. Because that's what filled up my phone. I'm like, this is what we have to do all day? There are people lost and dying and going to hell. There are homes being broken apart by the power of sin and Satan. And all we worry about, all we fret about, all we talk about, all we express is discomfort with an election? We adore, cherish, esteem, and idolize a whole lot of fluff. We lift up our children, their accomplishments. We lift up what we've done, what we enjoy, what we love, but we often fail to lift up the one who has saved us, the one who sent his son down to earth, the one who controls every single thing. And 2021 ought to be a time when the curtains are pulled back, that others can see only God. We praise politics and politicians. We deem importance, God forbid, sports teams and games and figures. I am not against children. I'm not against politics. I'm not against sports. But I'm against those things when they take the place that only God should have. And the Bible says in Psalm 147, to praise the Lord. What that word praise means, and it's real simple, to express adoration. That means that expression may be inward, it may be outward, but it's always supposed to be upward. That means when we come to church, we ought to express praise to God. Verse number one tells us one way to do that. What was that little word again? Starts with an S, ends in ing. Help me. Sing. We don't sing because we don't have enough things to fill the time with. I can preach longer. In fact, just so you know, when I was working on this particular series of sermons, it was supposed to be one sermon. Typically in my notes, if my notes are 3 pages, that's one sermon for me. Just how I work with my notes. Somebody asked me how long these notes are for this sermon right here. Somebody asked me. Thanks for asking. I saw it, Brother Ash. 11. How many sermons? Only God knows. I don't even know. But the more I dug into this thought of only God, the more that my heart was burdened and challenged. All right, and brought to a point, if the curtains of my heart, and yes, it's to us, but it's to me as well. Understand, as I sit in my study, I look at my own life. God, are you only the only God in my life? I want to praise the Lord. I want to express praise to Him. How often does God come up in your conversation? It's an expression. You see, I see you in church. I sit on this side, you sit on this side, right? You watch me, I watch you. I've led songs for many years before, Lord, let me be the pastor here. The problem that I face at times is that I see many of you at games too, sporting events. Many of you, I see your Facebook feed. There's no shortage of passion in that. No shortage. Yet we come to church, and what happens at church? We sit down and shut up. Oh, we open our mouths at times, and a smile cracks our face at moments. But where? Where's the praise? Where's the expression? Inward and outward, but always upward. Where's the expression? Where is the losing of oneself? I've heard greater passion in stories about your anger at a vehicle in front of you, than praise to your God? Where's our praise? This morning, I was stuck for a moment behind a slow-moving vehicle. I will not mention Miss Jenny's name again tonight. I would not do that. But on the way to church tonight, I was stuck behind a lawless rebel of society on the way to church. This morning it was 35 and a 35. Tonight it was 45 and a 35. I had to follow to see who this reckless pagan was who would go 50 down Dixie Highway. Thankfully, I barely could stay up with them. I was shocked when Rob Moore pulled into the parking lot. Not that I would mention that or anything. It's time, my friend, to praise the Lord. And I don't mean just at church. I'm going to talk about singing at church in a little bit here. I'm going to talk about that. But I'm talking about praise the Lord all of the time. All right, so I'm a little tired of people trying to play church. And I'll tell you this, though I'm passionate and burned tonight, I'm encouraged by First Baptist Church. I'm encouraged when I see your faces here. You encourage me every service here as I see you sing. But that doesn't mean we have arrived. We have not arrived yet. I have not arrived. You have not arrived. And faithful is he that called you, who also will do it. One day we will arrive when Jesus Christ comes back to earth. But I'm encouraged by the strength I see. But I'm challenged. I'm burdened by the ones who want to play church. Tonight, we want to praise him. I want to give you two reasons to praise him. First of all, because he is the master. Another passage in Psalm 115, it says this, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory for thy mercy and for thy truth's sake. Wherefore should the heathen say, where is now their God? But our God is in the heavens. He hath done whatsoever he hath pleased." And the world may say, wow, this thing is around us. Where's God? I'll tell you where God is. The same place he was before 2020 and the same place he'll be after 2020. He's in heaven and he does whatever he wants to do. He's our God and he is worthy of our praise. Only God can move mountains. And when he moves them, you don't miss it. Only God can work all things together for good. Have you not seen the hand of God? He is around us. He works in and through us. Times we'll see part of the veil pulled back from our eyes and we'll see the working of God and we're amazed. I know that we'll get to heaven and we'll see all the things that God is doing and how this led to this and led to this and salvation was brought and lives were transformed because God as master does anything he wants to do and he works all things together according to his plan. Only God can hear and answer prayers. May 2021 be a year of prayer for you. Only God can reward as the righteous judge. You know, as children, or for our children, we'll tell them things like Jesus is watching you, and that is true, and that we'll stand before him and be rewarded for things done in the body, and that is true. But I fear that sometimes we just give it in a negative connotation that we'll answer for all the bad things we do, and we almost want to live in fear. And while that is true, it is equally as true that God sees every righteous decision you make, every time that you walk by faith, whether it was the smallest step or the largest leap, God sees it and he takes note of that and he will reward for those walks and acts and decisions and choices that you make in faith. When you give in the offering and you alone know that that amount was sacrificial, God sees that. When you give a kind word to the one that is in need and no one else knows, God sees that. When you bite your tongue and in your spirit you respond in a way that is loving, that is not natural to you, God sees that. And God alone, is a righteous judge. I'm so glad that God sees things clearly. You can't fool God. He knows your motives. He knows if you and I are self-serving. People, we judge motives. I know what they were thinking. I know what they meant by that. I know what they wanted by that. But God knows. Only God deserves the preeminence in my life. As a master, I give him praise and reverence. That word means deep respect or hold with dignity. We live in a time where Christians are trying to dishonor, disregard, and disrespect God. The world has always done that. Jesus says, don't be surprised if they hate you. They hated me first. That is not a surprise. That will always happen till God comes back. All right, there will be an opposition to God. But we live now in a time where Christians desire and are demeaning our God, our Savior, our Master. They assign to God promises He never made before. They will tell you that if you just follow this God, He will bless you no matter what. I wish it were true. Now, it is true that He will bless you, but the interpretation of blessing will be different. What they often mean by that is that you will have financial success beyond your wildest imagination. I wish that were true, but I know it not to be true. There are times that God does deem to do that, and I think it's wonderful. I am happy to see a faithful, committed, extremely wealthy Christian. I'm even more happy if they're here at First Baptist Church. And I have greater joy to find out that they're a faithful tither as well, of course. But they assign Him promises He never made. They accuse Him of a pettiness of which God is not, and they assassinate His character. They say, God wants you to be infinitely happy. Now the problem is, Jesus says, I'll give you my joy. But what they mean by that is, you need to be content and comfortable with how you come to God. That's why they trade consecration for convenience. Come to the early service and you can still have your golf tee time. If this service doesn't work for your children, we'll have another one. Because somehow they're trying to convince us, I was talking about Christians now, that God is most concerned about my convenience in life. I've read my Bible through a number of times. I've never found a place where it says God is concerned about my convenience. In fact, I read the exact opposite. That God doesn't care if it's convenient or not. I mentioned this morning, I've been reading in Genesis, and Abraham, he's called to leave. That's not convenient. The fiery furnace, that's not convenient. The lion's den, that's not convenient. Getting betrayed by Judas, that's not convenient. I'm never called the convenience, I'm called the consecration. Instead of sacrifice, there's selfishness. Instead of commitment, there's comfort. Instead of exhortations, there's just explanations. In fact, be aware, look for less church that is supposedly called better church. So we'll have less of church, but this will be better. It's a few years back, and I was talking to someone who said that's why they went to a limited church schedule. They said we can put a lot more time into the service throughout the week and really focus. I understand that. Imagine if I only had to study for one sermon a week instead of three. Unfortunately, I love studying the Bible. But to study for one, you could do a lot of things with just for one study, but why stop there? If you can do all that with one service a week, imagine if you had just one service a year. And for 52 weeks you planned for one service. That'd be a great service, would it not? Imagine the money spent on that service and the PowerPoint and the slides and the videos and the effects you could have and the illustrations in that service. But why stop there? Imagine if you had every 5 years just one service. Imagine if you worked for 5 years. But why stop there? Why not go 10 years? But why stop there? Why not go every 20 years and have one service? Can you imagine what that sermon would be like if I was able to study for 20 years? It'd be long, I'll tell you that much. Wouldn't be no 3 pages or 11 pages. Yet they say less church is better church. I mentioned this morning, but I was reading this past week about current church trends, and they said look for 2021 for senior pastors and lead pastors to look for more content, less reps. I mean by that is a better sermon, but less sermons a year. And they said this, they had asked pastors of large churches or churches the average time they spoke a year at their church, and the average was 33 to 39 times a year. A year. That's not even every single week, once a week. Look for less church to be better called better church. Be aware of churches claiming authenticity as a thin veil for entertainment. You see, 2020 pulled back and revealed self. Revealed self. God desires our reverence. And many want to assign him to their convenience or part of a political party. God is not Republican. God is not a Democrat. God is not conservative or liberal. God transcends all of that. He is God. He is not defined by me. He is defined by his word. Everything I know about God, I find right here. Apart from this book, I would not know God. I would know of a greater being. The heavens declare the glory of God. Which God is that? The one that in the beginning created the heavens and the earth. Apart from this book, I don't know God. God is worthy of our reverence. He's also worthy of our relationship. We praise him when we have a relationship with him. Someone wrote this, how big is God? How big and wide in his vast domain? To try and tell, these lips can only start. He's big enough to rule this mighty universe, yet small enough to live within my heart. I wonder, in your praise, what your relationship with God looks like. I believe you ought to spend time with God every single day. And it wouldn't be a bad thing multiple times a day. I had a teacher once in college. He's made this statement. He goes, I think reading your Bible begins with reading your Bible and then stops with reading your Bible. Caught my attention as a student. He went on to explain what he meant. He said, if I were to read the newspaper, obviously it was a long time ago when newspapers were still a thing. He goes, I would not say I read the newspaper this morning and then put it away. He went on to explain, he said, if someone were to ask me if I read the newspaper, he said, I would say, sure. In the morning, I looked at the front page, and at lunch, I picked it up, and I happened to look at the sports section. At supper, I was looking through the editorials in the back. So yeah, I guess I did read the newspaper today. And he said, you all get to a place in your life where time in God's word is just a natural all-day-long occurrence. Dedicated time, dedicated place. People reject that. Well, it will feel forced. If you set aside a time, and we don't want to force the relationship with God, it ought to just come natural and be authentic. Yet I have a dedicated place that I eat. I have a dedicated place that I clean up every morning, take a shower. Doesn't feel forced, it's just where I clean up. I don't think it's wrong at all to have a dedicated time where you spend time with God and shut the rest of life out. 2021, only God. We didn't miss too many meals this year, did we? Well, if you look at me, I didn't miss too many. Did you miss any of this? 2021 or 2020? I got a text yesterday about a new Bible plan given by a pastor. He was challenging people to read through the Bible in a year. Which I think is tremendous. Not everyone should do what I do, but a few years back, I began to read through my Bible every 90 days. I did that for me. I saw and noticed Pastor Ouellette did that, and I noticed how much the Word of God would if I can leak out of him. And I liked that. If you want something to leak out of you, you got to shove a whole bunch of it inside of you. There's only one scoop. Not much can leak out. So I began then to read through the Bible maybe 6 or 7 years ago now, or maybe not that much, every 3 months or so. I don't say that to brag or not. Please understand my heart. It's just what I do, and not everyone should do that, but I find it helpful for me. But this particular pastor was challenging those to read through the Bible in a year, which I think is tremendous. If you've never read through your Bible, Christian, I hope you do. In fact, this year, my whole family and I were reading through the Bible in a chronological Bible, from myself to my wife to Johnny, James, and Danielle. We're 3 days in, and so far, we're still successful. Ask me in 6 months how it's going. It's been neat, the conversations we've had about what each of us has learned and the different perspective from each of the different minds. This pastor said, you know, I split this Bible plan up not into day by day because life is full of unexpected twists. And one day is busy, the other day is not. So I find it's better to go by week so the days I have more time, I could spend more time. Sounds to me like it's convenience. Why don't you break it up by months? By years? Bible says we're supposed to praise the Lord, and I draw to a close tonight. I hope your life, I challenge that your life will be one that will bring an expression of adoration to Him. So many other things that dominate our lips, our feeds, our passion, desires, and delight. But how about in 2021, we have Christians who commit to this year praising God. At home, praise God. Driving down the road, praise God. Praise Him for the things that happen that you expect. Praise Him for the countless things that you don't expect. 1998, it was Game 5 of the World Series. Oakland Athletics hosted by the Los Angeles Dodgers. In front of 50,000 fans and millions more by television, the Dodgers' mighty pitcher, well, the trophy you know, Oral Hershiser, was pitching. His team, the Dodgers, were up 3-1. But as the camera zoomed in on him, they spotted him mumbling to himself. Apparently, it was an impressive year for Oral Hershiser. In regular season, he'd pitched several complete game shutouts and set a new record for pitching 59 consecutive innings with no runs allowed. Prompted many, many to tune in. But the sight of Hershiser sitting in the dugout with his lips moving for no apparent reason made many, including the game's commentators, scratch their heads. The rest of the night, Oral Hershiser, the Bulldog, led his Dodgers to victory, clinching the 88 World Series. Already possessing the Cy Young Award, the Gold Glove, and the MVP of the National League, he was also named MVP of the World Series. In the ensuing celebration, no one thought to ask him about that. It was a little while later he was on the Johnny Carson Tonight Show. Comedian asked Oral Hershiser what he had been talking about, what he had been saying. And Oral Hershiser said this a little bit reluctantly and bashfully, admitted he had been singing. Apparently, the studio howled with delight and shouted for him to sing for them. He refused graciously and said, "There's no way I'm singing." Johnny Carson responded, "Oh, yes, you are," to the delight of the audience. Within moments, the crowd silenced themselves as all eyes and ears were on Oral Hershiser that night. He began to sing the same song that he'd sung to himself in the dugout that historic night, with words that go like this: "Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
We know it as the doxology. Orr went on to say that he was just reminding himself of his God. So Christian, 2021 ought to be a year of praise. Not to our political party, not for our children, not for how much money we save, not for our likes and dislikes, for the one who saved us. Are you praising the Lord? Lord, I thank you for your care, your concern. Lord, I ask you would search our hearts tonight. We often get distracted, distanced, and discouraged by many things. Lord, often our passion and desires are turned somewhere else besides you. Lord, may this year, may we commit to praise for you. My friend, in just a moment, the instruments will play. I wonder if God's touched your heart. If so, the altar's open. Don't wait till we stand, but you come now. As the curtains were pulled off your heart in 2020, what was revealed? Was it only God? Was it your discomfort? Was it your desires, your passions? Oh, may others see us this year and praise. May it come from our lips and from our heart. Lord, I ask for your help. May our hearts and our spirits be turned towards you. Lord, may we respond like we ought to during this time. In Jesus' name, amen.